I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line.
I'm Mort Cooper, your host on Change Your Voice, Change Your Life. Cures is a dirty word. Think about it. For 35 years, I've been reporting cures of strangled voices and other so-called hopeless voices with peer review. I'm a former assistant clinical professor, UCLA Medical Center, head of neck division, served with Jack Pressman for 8 years, said I was the best speech pathologist he ever knew. Let's take a listen to cures of strangled voices called spasmodic dysphonia. All medicine, all academia, the drug company Allergan guarantees in writing there are no cures. I report cures. It's a dirty word. Let's listen.
Well, for anybody who's listening to this tape, watching it, if you can imagine that you cannot speak clearly or in a very dysfunctional way, that means you cannot function, period. You cannot do anything. You cannot function with your friends. You cannot function at work. And where do you take that? The trauma is huge. So if there is the potential to help people, that information needs to be put out there. It needs to be made available to people.
Robin, you were diagnosed at UCLA Medical Center.
That's correct.
By one of the finest doctors in the country, Dr.
Right.
Gerald Burke, the chairperson of the head and neck division.
UCLA and also USC.
Right. What did Dr. Burke tell you?
They said it was spasmodic dysphonia, and the only medical option which was offered was Botox injections, which I perceived as a very invasive procedure with pretty limited prospects of success. And I was also led to believe that it would be okay for a while, short period of time, and then I would have to continue having more injections, which essentially paralyzes your vocal cords, and the whole concept was very off-putting to me. It's also lethally dangerous because you can end up with a voice with a whisper as opposed to a success.
Yes, yes.
Which is what he achieved with my voice. I isolated, I couldn't function. I cut off from people because if somebody would call me and the first thing they would say is, "What's wrong with you?" I just didn't want to deal with it. So it was just a traumatic time. You can't function in any way at all. You can't function socially. You can't work. Where do you go with that? You're so clammed up and depressed and jammed up that it's impossible. So that's the problem. I don't know what the technical terms are. Let me just put it in simple language. I had an appalling speech problem.
Caused spasmodic dysphonia.
Right.
Diagnosed by Dr. Burke, Dr. Liu at USC, Dr. Burke at UCLA.
Right. They told me that with the Botox, which was the solution which was offered, I don't know who specifically told me, but somewhere along the way I gathered that the Botox is not always successful. There is an option or a possibility that the voice can end up simply as a whisper. And I also gathered somewhere along the line that the Botox, which I understand to be a toxin, can actually damage the voice in a very dangerous way. So there seem to be all kinds of potential for problems and minimal prospects for success, and also that this kind of band-aid treatment of Botox would have to be administered again and again and again. All of which put me off completely.
You went to UCLA. You saw Dr. Burke, one of the finest surgeons in the field. He wanted to give you Botox. You went to USC. Is that correct?
Right, yeah.
You saw the chairperson there.
I did.
Dr. Rice. They wanted to give...
Dr. Liu.
Dr. Lou. It wasn't Dr. Rice, Dr. Lou.
Right, and their intentions were the best.
I have no question about their intentions. They had the best of intentions, mm-hmm. the humanitarian. What was their take?
I think in both instances that the solution which was suggested was the Botox injections.
Mm-hmm.
What seems disturbing is that when a new concept comes to light, mm-hmm. like the success that you have had, mm-hmm. in a whole system of red tape which is preventing them from opening up to the fact that there is actually a cure being offered.
Yes.
So they are totally stuck there. In the meantime, mm-hmm. there are a lot of people suffering a really yes. tragic issue mm-hmm. with speech problems. How can it be brought to the attention of whoever is appropriate, the medical profession, whoever it is, mm-hmm. that there is a healing syndrome available?
Mm-hmm.
And why should they be threatened by that? Shouldn't they embrace it and acknowledge it?
Did you ever consider suicide because of your problem?
It's a very personal question. Depression definitely comes with the territory.
Mm-hmm.
And what the professionals, the psychiatrists and psychologists, I guess,
mm-hmm.
say that suicidal ideation,
mm-hmm.
quotes, the technical term,
mm-hmm.
is very much part of the territory with mm-hmm. depression,
mm-hmm.
which is kind of a polite way of saying, yes, the mm-hmm. depression was mm-hmm. so traumatic
mm-hmm.
that one would like an out.
Mm-hmm.
But I had spiritual beliefs which carried me through that, and I had hopes and kind of a determination and an optimism to find a cure. So where your question goes into the depths of depression, which is the depths of the tragicness of the problem,
mm-hmm.
yes, and that makes it absolutely criminal that any self-interest mm-hmm. groups would prevent the kind of information which you have to offer
mm.
from being readily available.
This young man remains cured, as far as I know, from his spasmodic dysphonia. You heard his clear voice. He could barely talk when I originally saw him. The rumor is that spasmodic dysphonia has a high suicide rate. Meanwhile, the medical profession, academia, and the Botox company, Allergan, guarantee there are no cures, as I report for over 35 years, ongoing cures of all kinds of conditions of spasmodic dysphonia, adductor, abductor, and mixed type. This patient was seen at UCLA, diagnosed by Dr. Gerald Burke and by a professor high surgeon at USC, cured. Let's move on. Individuals who have spasmodic dysphonia, diagnosed by UCLA Medical Center, and the voice that they diagnosed as spasmodic dysphonia, with Gail Pace.
A round of antibiotics, and then they put me on a stronger antibiotic, and I took that, and I began to feel good, but the voice has been a mess ever since.
When was the flu? How many months ago?
It was in March, the end of March. When I did go to a speech therapist for a while, but that didn't. I mean, some days I'd go in there and I was fine, just like I am all the time. I couldn't tell that did anything at all.
Now we're about to listen to the cured voice of Gail Pace. Let's take a listen.
At that point, I was so depressed that I wondered about everything. I didn't want to. I'd had people really say mean things to me.
Mm-hmm.
I had worked most all the time, and people are unkind a lot.
Especially if you don't have your voice.
Right. And so I had become rather withdrawn, actually. Mm-hmm. And that's not exactly normal. In fact, there's a list, very, very long, of all the different medications that they gave me
mm-hmm.
and different things that we tried. I went to a speech therapist. I even took